Excellent. Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining today, this morning, this evening. I don't know where we are. I am in sunny Toronto, Canada. Don't get to say that too often. There's no snow, in case you're wondering. But I'm seeing things come in from Algeria, from Turkey, from Tunisia, from Canada, from the U.S. We'll do our best to try and use vernacular today that will make sense to everybody. Pakistan, geez, this truly is global. Well, thank you everyone for joining. Probably didn't join to hear me talk about countries or cities. What we are going to talk about today is being your own boss and the career of a contractor. We're going to take questions along the way. So if you fire them into the chat, one of my colleagues is going to help me out with them. But, you know, I can make myself pretty available after the fact. If you want to send me private messages or an email, I'll probably end up plugging your local Hayes office and make sure you can reach out to them as well, because I'm only one person of a giant team at Hayes who are keen to help you in your future career as a contractor. Okay, we'll keep rolling here. What you're going to learn during the event is a lot of things, but for me, the key is probably setting a baseline. What is a contractor and what do they do? Why is there such high demand in 2023? Now, I think this is going to continue at least into 2024. Maybe it's a change in the way we work altogether, but it's certainly going to be huge this year. And why is that? Well, there's major benefits to becoming a contractor. There's a lot of industries or functional areas within the world of work that prefer or at least are looking to move towards more of a contractor-heavy workforce. And in order to take advantage of that kind of change in the way that we work, what are the skills that you are going to need? What do you need to think about before you take that jump? So we're going to try and get as much as we can, and we want to make sure that you leave this session with at least one step closer to how you can get started and what you need to do to achieve kind of lifelong success, provided this is the type of work you want to get into. Reminder again, if you drop questions or comments, we've got more people joining from Brazil, from Germany, from France. This is excellent. So really appreciate the audience today. Okay, let's dive in, as they say. So what is a contractor and what do they do? Now, for me, the vernacular is really important because contractor in one country can mean something different in another country. I always try and break it down to what is a contingent worker, and a contingent worker will kind of cover contractor and a few other classes. Ultimately, it is a non-permanent employee, somebody who can come in from time to time. They tend to be a specialist in a given field. I often refer to it as a hired gun from the old Western movies. They are somebody that you bring in to deliver a specific item, a specific thing, a specific action, a specific project. It's usually more on the short-term basis. You say usually, it's not entirely. Very often, you know, you come across a big five-year project, we're building a bridge, and we need contractors to come in and help with that. And maybe we need you for the entire 5 years. Maybe it's 3 years, but there's all sorts of different kind of lengths. Traditionally, it's more on the smaller side. Another big one is you are your own boss. Now, that's a really, really important piece of this, because some of the biggest companies in the world started with one person working as a contractor. You know, very often you might leave it. You might say, I only ever want to be a single human being working in a business. But some of the biggest and baddest tech companies started as one person in a garage. They were probably a contractor. They had an incorporated business and it grew. The idea was great. Their ambition was greater. And here we are today. So it's important to look at this as a long-term career play for yourself. Now, what is a contractor and how does it differ from, I guess, other types of work? So the thing we'll look at first is on the contractor side. Typically, it means you're managing your own business. A contractor will have a highly desired skill set. I often refer to them as knowledge workers. You're being hired to bring in a specific skill. Sometimes it's in your brain and makes you a knowledge worker. Sometimes it can be with your hands, but it's usually a skill set that is rare in the marketplace and that the organization does not have internally. For co-employment reasons, for business reasons, typically you will have your own tools. If you work in technology, it probably means you have your own laptop. if you work as a welder, you might have your own truck, but usually a key to running your own business is you have your own tools. You know, how often, you know, someone shows up to your house to deliver a service and says, hey, can I borrow your hammer? That would probably be a flag that this is the wrong contractor that you should be working with. The next one would be you could use multiple clients. Sometimes your work is so specialized, there isn't 40 hours a week in work to do. Maybe there's not even 20. You might be somebody who comes in, runs assessments, you do it for 8 hours, you move on to the next project. So it's very, very normal, almost encouraged to run a number of projects at any given time. That's like a sign of like a really true successful contractor. Other than, you know, as an employee, typically your pay rates will be set by the employer, or there'll be an offer. Hey, this role pays $43 per hour. When you run your own business, you'll say, by the way, to use my services, this is what it would cost. And it's $43 per hour. So just to kind of a change in the balance of power for who sets the rates. Now, if we contrast that versus a temp, personally, I don't love the phrase temp. I don't think anybody wants to be known as a temp. But the vernacular we use here tends to be you're not running a business and you're still running short-term work. That would be a temporary employee. Sometimes this could be referred to, depending on what country you're in, it could be a payee in the UK. It could be a W-2 if you work in the US. It could be a T-4 if you're in Canada. And that's really how you differentiate a business versus a temporary employee. Usually a temp, using that language, is brought in to cover very short periods of time. It could be an absence. It could be, you know, someone over the holidays is taking an extra 2 weeks vacation. Or it might just be peaks and valleys. If we think about the holidays again, there's some industries, you know, if you work for, you know, large shipping organization, they'll hire huge call centers to make sure they can get through the December rush of all the packages that are flying around. And they'll bring in temporary workers to do that. Sometimes you'll see, you know, a big concert. Big concert comes to town. We need 400 people to manage security or concessions. We're going to bring in some temporary employees who can do that, because the concert's one night. It's not going to go on, you know, for weeks. So that would be two kind of big markers of what a temp is. When you show up to that concert, if you're handing out popcorn, I would say it's unlikely / like never. Are you going to bring your own popcorn making machine? You're going to use the equipment. You're going to take the direction from your employer. And then probably the last piece is you're only going to have one employer at a time. Now that might cycle pretty quickly. You might do something on a Tuesday for one company and a Thursday for another. It's also entirely possible, maybe based on shift work, you do Tuesday, Wednesday for one organization and Thursday, Friday for another. And then you go back to the first one on Saturday. So you could have multiple engagements, but primarily as a temp, you're working for one company because you've been hired to do some work rather than for your knowledge or for a specialist expertise. You're helping a business that already exists. So that would be kind of the main differences between a temporary worker and a contractor. And why is there such a high demand for contractors in 2023? Now, I did highlight 2023 for sure, but I expect the high demand to continue, at least for the foreseeable. Definitely comfortable saying into 2024. The biggest driver are skills gaps. So if we pick on an industry like technology, there just aren't enough technology workers. We're not graduating enough from post-secondary school. We're not doing a good enough job training individuals as employers. We're probably not promoting it enough in high schools to get people to, you know, take that as a career path. And as a result, there is a massive shortage of technology workers. So what ends up happening is you end up creating, you know, a bit of a war for talent, as you've heard. Company A wants to hire a Java developer, and then company B goes and takes that Java developer, and then company A has to go replace their role, and it ends up hiring contractors to come in, deliver very short-term pieces of work, could be a month, could be about 2 years, but to address skills gaps. That's like a very, very common one. When you can bring somebody in to do a year or a month at a time, You typically want to hire somebody who's at a more advanced skill set. You want to bring somebody in who can make an impact to your business immediately. And when you do things like technology upgrades, often you need somebody who can come in right away. They have that knowledge that you don't have in the business. You don't want to have to train them. You want them to come in and on day one, maybe day two, they start to make an impact to your business. And really true good contractors have the ability to do that quickly. You don't have to do that 1 month of learning. It can be very low, much lower cost for organizations. Now, this will be contrasting on the next slide when I talk about how you can make more money as contracting. But what I mean here is when you hire a contractor, maybe you only need a work you have enough work for a month, or you have enough work for 6 months. So why would an organization hire a full-time employee? When you hire a full-time employee, you start to bring in considerations like severance pay or stock options that you must give because you've given them to everyone else. Or maybe it's just medical benefits, or maybe it's vacation pay. So organizations will often hire contractors because all they're focused on is the hourly rate or the project rate of that worker. So it can be significantly lower cost as an employer. It allows them to scale up and down the workforce quickly. If you work in an industry that's heavily seasonal, you know, anything in agriculture, for example, specifically in Canada, where there's going to be a lot of snow, it doesn't make sense for you to hire people full time. And you've got 200 people for 12 months of the year, when really you only need them during that high season, whether it's the summer or the fall. So oftentimes organizations will hire contractors to bring them in to hire a massive peak in work demand. And then when the work's done, the contract is completed. And that will often be a cyclical thing, not just in agriculture, obviously. Sometimes you'll have buildings, you know, a developer or a construction company, you know, it's 2 years of work. We're going to grow the workforce a lot. And then after those 2 years, we're going to scale down, wait for the next project to start. So a scalable workforce is a huge driver. And then possibly the last one, and maybe the most important one to some people on this call, is the changing needs of workers. You know, when I was growing up, everyone was a permanent employee. And that was kind of the way that you worked. You climbed the ladder, and the world of work has changed. And it's very often looked at now is your work experience is a portfolio. It's a portfolio of work, of organizations and skills that you gained access to. I think the pandemic changed a lot of people's motivations and the amount of time that they want to spend at home, the amount of time they want to spend doing things that follow their passion. And as a result, a lot of people want to become contractors full time. They're not worried about that job security or the benefits or the vacation, because they know their skills in such demand, they can jump left and right and they have no problem finding where that next paycheck is going to be. So the changing needs of workers is one of the ways, or one of the reasons, that contractors are in such a high demand. Okay, so what industries? You want to get into it. Some of these are going to be industries. Some of these are going to be functional areas. We'll kind of just touch on them quickly. Within technology, we spoke about that. I want to be clear. There's the tech industry, you know, organizations like Meta, and then there's tech functional type work. So banks will hire technology workers. Government hires technology workers. So technology is very heavily used as contractors, both in the industry and the functional area. I would echo that into engineering. Engineering can be a job or a function. It can also be a sector. So engineers, whether you're in automotive, or you're in oil and gas, or you're building a bridge, as I spoke about earlier, or you're in the telco industry. Engineers very often are contractors because you bring in specialist expertise that doesn't exist within your business today. Engineering as a sector, when you look at consulting, also very heavy contractor, because usually those organizations will bounce from project to project. So engineering, very heavy usage of contractors. Mining, lots of contractors. You will have a mine that starts or a mine that stops, or they're doing a new exploration. And again, those can have defined start and end dates. Consulting, same thing. You're going to come in, you're going to try and solve a problem or provide a piece of expertise. Tends to not be a longer period of time. Energy, you know, natural resources, very similar to mining. There could be an exploration. There could be a huge project. Maybe that well runs dry. Maybe we move to a bigger field somewhere else. And then pharmaceutical, again, coming back to that expertise. Now, this list is not fully comprehensive. There are many other sectors. There's many other functional areas that do use contractors, but we wanted to highlight some of the big ones. Now, what are the benefits? Salary, or maybe salary is, you know, not the best word to use. I'll call it total compensation. Very frequently, let's say if you are a Java developer, right? You might have an offer for $100,000. I'm speaking in dollars. Hope that's okay with everybody. $100,000 to be a Java developer. But to do the same piece of work, you might be able to make $75 per hour as a contractor. Now, $75 per hour over the course of a full work life or for a full work year would be $150,000 in take-home money. So the same job, the same person, you could be sitting side by side. One person is an employee at $100,000, and the hourly worker might be earning $150,000. Now, maybe that hourly worker actually has a second customer. Maybe they have their own passion project that they're doing on the side. So when you work as a contractor, you can have multiple employers. You can typically charge a higher hourly wage because you're not getting those stock options or those benefits that we spoke about earlier, but you don't have the job security. So, you know, there's positives and negatives to both. We'll speak about that in a little bit. Flexibility, typically a contractor, because you're hired a hired gun and you bring in specialist expertise, you get a little bit more leeway with the organization you're providing a service to. Maybe they don't need to see you every day. Maybe they don't need to see you at all. They just want to make sure the work is actually being completed. It's much more common for contractors to be flexible workers, at least full-time versus full-time employees today. So if that's something that you're really passionate about, I would absolutely encourage you to do that. When you're a contractor, contractually and otherwise, you are your own boss. I don't advise this, but maybe you'll wake up on Thursday morning and just say, I don't feel like working today. Maybe you'll decide, you know what, I'm going to shut it down at 3 o'clock today. When you're a contractor, one of the key things to maintaining that legal status is that you are in control of your own work. You decide how it will be completed. As soon as an employer is saying, no, you must start at this time and you must do your work this way and you must finish by this time and you must tell me when you're going on vacation or you must tell me how when you started and finished lunch, that starts to feel like an employee. A contractor is usually a true business and you don't tell a business those things. Maybe you'll try and influence it, but contractually, you are your own boss and it's very important that the way that you operate replicates what is featured inside of that contract. Last one, I would say variety. Variety is a really important one. I'll keep using technology because it's an example that might resonate with a lot of people on LinkedIn. It would be unlikely that your organization would change their entire tech stack with any frequency, any great frequency. Maybe they'll change their tech stack every 10 years or 15 years or 20 years. So if you want to get experience with different pieces of technology, you're going to have to jump around. You're going to have to go from company A to company B to company C. And as a full-time employee, that doesn't look great on the resume when you're somebody who jumps around a bit. As a full-time employee, you'll probably be leaving money on the table. If you know you're going to jump every 2 or 3 years, you might as well be a contractor and use some of those high hourly wages that we spoke about earlier. Taking a full-time job when you know you're going to leave doesn't necessarily make the greatest financial sense, but it will still give you the ability to get access to that new technology. Could be a new city. It could be a new industry. It gives you a greater work portfolio that we spoke about earlier. Okay, so just some of the great benefits. There's others. The one I started the meeting with talking about, it's your chance to build your own business. Some of the biggest companies today started as one person working as a contractor. And that could be whether you're in energy or oil and gas, you're providing a skilled trade. It could be within technology. It could be that you're just a consultant. Every organization at one point or another started with one person with an idea. So if you want to bet on yourself, if you want to make it to the top, you want to be that billionaire in that private jet, it's typically working for yourself with a great concept and backing you. If you want to work for an employer and have that job security, it's a different path, but everything kind of changes depending on what your motivations are at that point in your life. Okay, where are we going next? Quick stat for you. I won't read it to you, but we'll give you this deck afterwards if you'd like to. The skills that you're going to need. Now, this is going to be, you know, changing based on the sector, but the technical expertise probably goes without saying. If you're going to be a welder, you damn well better know how to weld before you take a job as a contractor. So that stuff is largely, self-explanatory. But the motivation, you have to be a self-motivated individual. If a contract ends every 6 months or every 12 months, you have to be prepared to get out there and find that next assignment. You might need to network. You might need to be on platforms like LinkedIn, sending lots of emails, doing lots of connections, doing lots of branding for yourself. You need to learn how to run your own organization. There's going to be, if you're incorporated, now all of a sudden, maybe there's some insurance requirements that you're going to have. Maybe you need an accountant. Maybe you need to learn that you're better off to pay yourself via dividends in your company than you are to pay yourself an hourly rate. So there's a lot of considerations as to how you actually run a business. You need to be adaptable. If you're going to start at a new organization every 6 months or every 12 months, you're going to run into different technology stacks, different managers, different colleagues, different work cultures, potentially different countries or different cities. So you have to be highly adaptable. You have to be able to work with all walks of life, all different sorts of people, different backgrounds. And if that's something that you're not comfortable with, you prefer to just, you know your four or five coworkers, you've been with them for 15 years, and you like that comfort, contracting probably, almost certainly, is not going to be for you. Because building those relationships and doing that networking on day one is going to be key to your success in that project or at that organization. Knowing how to navigate within a company is often just as difficult as knowing how to actually do the work itself. To get things done, you need to build relationships fast, not just know how to write that code. Okay, so those are key skills. There's others. We have another stat that comes up in a moment. Again, I'm not going to read it to you, but happy to address any questions about kind of that data when we get to the end here. Okay, what should you think about before you start out? Do you have the right skills? And we spoke about some of kind of the, I'll call them softer skills in relationship building or in communication earlier, but do you actually have skills that are in demand? If you were to start as a contractor, is somebody going to hire you? Now, using LinkedIn and looking at job postings that are available by different organizations, speaking to a specialist, somebody at Hays in one of your local countries, we can tell you if your roles are more suited towards permanent employment or to contracting. But before you take the leap, you absolutely want to make sure that with, standard supply and demand, the demand is there before you bring the supply to the market. You need to think about, really be honest with yourself. You have to do a lot of reflection. If you're constantly changing coworkers, is that something that you enjoy? Some people will absolutely love it. Some people are just those people pleasers. They want to get out there. They want to meet new people. They want to have new experiences. They want to learn about new backgrounds or new cultures at a greater frequency than others. Some people, they're just comfortable in their set ways. So think very, very carefully. If you're the type of person who goes to a networking event and, you hide on the outside or you sit on the outskirts of the event because you don't want to go in and start introducing yourself and making friends, contracting might be a very stressful situation for you. And for the benefit of your own mental health and anxiety, it might not be the area you want to get into. If you're the type of person at a networking event who throws yourself right into the middle, you're walking up and you're shaking everyone's hands, and you want to learn about everyone else, contracting will probably be a natural fit for you. How do you measure progression? Well, a couple different ways you could do it. I would say the level of experience that you have. Did you get new technologies? Did you go up with each kind of new platform that tech stack released? As you take next assignment, is your level of responsibility increasing? What about your demand? Are more companies coming and approaching you and asking to bring you in as the expert? And probably the easiest way to measure your progression would be whether your hourly rate is improving. If your hourly rate keeps going up and you keep being in more demand, then honestly, I would say that's certainly a progression measure that I would be comfortable with. It offers probably different learning and development opportunities. At Hays, we're an organization that invests a lot in learning and development of our employees. Doesn't matter if you're on the recruitment side or the other side. But if we were to bring in a contractor, would we put that contractor into one of our management development programs? Or would we send that contractor to go get their CPA? Probably not. I'm actually comfortable saying no, we wouldn't. We invest in those things with our full-time employees. But if you're a contractor and you want to come in and you want to learn a new industry, or you want to get involved in our technology stack, you want to see what it's like working for a global organization, maybe you're a cyber specialist and you want to see how we operate, then you are definitely probably getting access to learning and development that you wouldn't get if you stayed at your current company. So how you measure learning and development, not dissimilar to how you measure progression, will depend on the individual, but I would say it offers a comparable amount of learning and development opportunities. It's just not going to be measured the same way. If you ever want to return to full-time employment, there's absolutely nothing stopping you. Personally, as an employer myself, I like to see people that have tried both. To me, it's a sign of somebody who was motivated and somebody who's ambitious, somebody who's willing to bet on themselves because they want to try engaging with different industries or different employers or different employment vehicles. So if that person who was a contractor for 5 years, they wanted to come work for us full time, I would absolutely consider that person. There are some organizations, to be blunt, that they'll always assume you're just going to quit and you're going to go start that next contract. So when you get into an interview for a full time job and you have been a contractor previously, speak to an expert like somebody at Hays to talk about how you can address those things in the job application process or in the interview. Because whether or not it is said, it will be something that is thought of by the person who's doing the interviewing. So in short, you can absolutely return to full-time employment. Maybe the contract that you're on, they might even offer you a full-time job, but there are things that you need to be wary of before you go back in order to make sure that you get a fair opportunity for that role. Another stat for you. So how do you get started? How can you get started and ensure that you will achieve lifelong success? First things first, grow your network. You're going to need to market yourself. You're going to need to market your business. Platforms like LinkedIn are probably the best if you work in more office-based jobs. If you want to work in a skilled trade, you're probably going to want to get out to more fairs, more industry events. You're going to want to look for referrals for current or past employees. You're going to want to look at what skills are in need. LinkedIn does a great job of highlighting every year what are the biggest skills in demand. I would say each country around January, whether it's newspapers or other media outlets, will identify the hottest jobs for that year. That will typically be a pretty good measure of where contractors are going to be required. You got to keep your portfolio up to date, whether that's your resume, whether that's your LinkedIn. Maybe you're a marketeer or a graphic designer and you really do have a portfolio, but keeping it fresh, no different than when you go to, you know, a restaurant, go to the website and the website still has the menu listed from the fall or what's hot this winter. And you're thinking, hang on a second, it's the spring or maybe it's the summer right now. If I go to a company's website and it's not up to date, that scares me because if they don't put their time into keeping what I see, their go-to-market strategy live, then what are they also not spending their time on? Maybe they're just disorganized. And why would I hire that specialist expert or that hired gun to come in if they appear to be disorganized? So keeping your LinkedIn or your resume or your online portfolio up to date is going to be critical. And then I would say you need to be constantly looking at opportunities. Set up alerts, whether it's in LinkedIn or any of the job boards or freelancer management networks. You want to know what types of organizations hire your roles. Maybe you won't be available to take that next job at that bank, but put it on a list so that when your project does come to completion 6, 8, 12 months later, you're going to be able to go back to that company and say, by the way, you had an opportunity 6 months ago and I wasn't free, but I do want to speak to you now in case you have any, you know, comparable roles. Speaking to organizations like Hays, we place, you know, tens of thousands of contractors every year. I often look at it as you treat a Hays recruiter similar to a soccer or a basketball player would treat their agent. It's our job to keep our ear to the market and to come to you with opportunities of a salary or a project that someone wants to offer you. Use us as your agent to bring you new opportunities. Okay. Finding the right learning resources. I think there's some soft skills that we mentioned there. Not everyone is a natural networker. Doesn't mean you can't get into contracting. There's going to be great things, whether it's Toastmasters or online courses for a way to learn how to integrate yourself. You want to stay on top of trends. I spoke to you about kind of watching jobs that are in demand, but things will fluctuate. We're headed into an economic period that a lot of people refer to as potential headwinds. And what is that going to do to the marketplace? Typically, when you head into times where people start using the R word, the recession word, contractors tend to spike up. We haven't seen that happening in the market just yet. I think you've got a lot of organizations who are still hanging on to their full-time employees for, you know, as long as possible, hopefully forever. But I won't be surprised if by the end of the summer or into the fall, we start to see a real big spike in contractors. And watching what's going on in the economy in your country is going to be a big part of that. Last but not least, I think I mentioned 6 or 7 or 8 times today to talk to Hayes, but really talk to Hayes. We are experts in the space. We are experts in the industries I alluded to earlier. We are experts in the functional areas that I spoke about. And we have hundreds of thousands of jobs that are being filled every single year. We have tens of thousands of jobs that are open today. I'm in Canada. We have over 1,000 openings. Talk to us. We can consult you on if the demand is there for your skill set. We can give you advice on what skill sets you might want to pick up in order to get that next contract. Or maybe we have that dream job, that dream project, that dream opportunity that you've always wanted. So reach out to a Hayes consultant in whatever your closest country would be. I'm going to stop for a moment. I'm going to take just a sip of water and see if there are any questions that have come in here. One moment. Is this applicable for any type of professional person? Any is a difficult word. I would say it's applicable for many professional persons. I'm going to interpret the way you use professional as being traditional, kind of like corporate services type roles. So procurement, lots of contractors, HR or people in culture. If you do project-based work, that will often result in contracting. If you work in accounting or finance, there are absolutely contractors, sometimes more on the temporary side. Maybe you're coming in to help with somebody's maternity leave cover, or we're installing a new system. But very often you do need expertise. That can be pretty common in financial analysis or within tax. So it is applicable to most professional persons. And I'm sorry if I've misinterpreted what you meant by a professional person. Can you become a contractor without qualifications? Yes. Not all, you know, industries require a specific qualification or designation. To be a contractor, you can often be self-taught. One of the things I would often refer to is an artist. Do you have a qualification or a designation? No, or maybe, but you might hire an artist to come in as a contractor to paint a beautiful mural, to do a custom piece of work for you and your family. Like, do you have qualifications? Well, your qualification is your experience, and your portfolio is what got you that job. So you don't necessarily need specific qualifications, but that's going to be very industry specific or role specific. If you have a specific question on that, I would encourage you to reach out to a Hayes employee. Can you do this while being mostly self-taught? I think I might have just answered that. Yes, you can definitely do it by being mostly self-taught. I think there's a lot of work out there, coding or development work. Like, it's one of those things where somebody who's self-taught in their basement could be equally or even more talented than somebody who's been doing it for 10 years. I think when you get into sectors that have a bit of art and a bit of science, it comes down to the talent of the individual. So you can absolutely become a contractor while being mostly self-taught. I think I've got the last question here, which is, how do we reach out to potential companies? Cold pitches don't really work. Well, I might disagree with you. I would say first thing you should do is reach out to a company like Hayes. Reach out to Hayes specifically, I would suggest. The second thing that I would do is make a lot of connections on LinkedIn. I would apply to postings, but I would try and figure out, well, hang on a second, who could be the hiring manager at that organization? And I would try and connect with that person. And when I had an audience, maybe somebody from Hayes, maybe somebody from kind of that end employer, I would absolutely have a pitch ready to go. If your cold pitches aren't working, I would say that you need to look at what is your cold pitch. If somebody came to me today and they had a phenomenal idea, would I turn them away because it was a cold pitch? Absolutely not. It's about the quality of the idea and the quality of how you've delivered that pitch is where I would be doing some reflection myself, because cold pitches absolutely do work. Okay, I got more questions coming in. Let's see. Do you have any suggestions as to how we can make ourselves stand out from competitors or other contractors with a similar skill set? It really depends on what your skill set is. If I'm trying to decide between hiring two different people, often what will send me over the edge is who wants it more? And if somebody just applies to a job and then sits there and waits, or someone applies to a job and then they send me a LinkedIn connection request, then they'll send me a LinkedIn email, then maybe they're actually going to send me an email, then they're going to find my phone number online, they're going to contact me. There's one person who I know has a lot of motivation, is really ambitious and really wants that role. And the other one, I'm kind of thinking, well, they probably applied to 40 other jobs that day. If you don't show the initiative to market yourself, why would I think you're going to show the initiative to get your work done on time? So to set yourself apart, I always say it's motivation and ambition, and show how badly you want that opportunity. And that to me was usually be what sets you apart from someone else. Okay, got another question. How does Hayes facilitate the relationship between contractor and client? Does the contractor have a contract in place with Hayes or the client directly? I would say 9.5 times out of 10, or 95% of the time, that you would have a contract with Hayes. We would have a business-to-business relationship with you, and then we would facilitate a relationship with our end client. That's usually the way that I recommend it, because the end client, that organization, might not need you after that 6-month period. But Hayes will have thousands of other clients. In Hayes Canada, we have over 1,000 customers. So if you finish a contract with, you know, customer 237, by the time you reach completion, I might have an opportunity for you at customer 745. So contracting with an organization like Hayes will typically help lead to your next opportunity, versus if you go direct to that customer, you might find yourself, you know, back on the job boards trying to find something else. So that would be my advice. Can you share a little bit about figuring out rate, how to figure out what you are worth? I'm going to give you the least surprising answer you've had so far, which is talk to Hayes. If you go to a Hayes website, you'll find our salary guide or a salary kind of surveys that sit within that. Most of those, depending on the country that you're in, will be largely permanent based. But the easiest way to do it as kind of what is a baseline, what is the lowest you could probably make as a contractor, would be quite simply divide it in two. So if the average salary is $50,000, I would say the lowest hourly rate that you should consider would be $25 per hour. If the average salary is $80,000, the lowest hourly rate I would consider, if I were you, would be $40 per hour. Now, usually you'll get a premium that goes up, particularly if you're one of those incorporated workers and you're not a temporary worker. You know, that $80,000 salary, you might be able to charge $50 an hour or $60 or $55 per hour. But speaking to a consultant at Hayes would be the next step that I would take. We place contractors every minute of every day, and we'll be able to give you a better idea as to what is the going rate for your skill set or your experience in the marketplace. Okay, one last glance down to see if there's any more questions. I'm seeing a lot come through in the chat. Apologies, I didn't get to all of them. Some of the great team members at Hayes are filtering them through for us. I think that's going to be it for today. I really, really thank all of you for joining. Some of you must have been in the middle of the night. Some of you are just getting ready for lunch. Regardless of where you are in the world, I certainly appreciate you listening to me today. One last plug, talk to a Hayes consultant. We are the experts, regardless of industry or functional area. We can give you guidance and we can help you become your own boss. So thank you very much, everyone, for joining today. And I hope you all have the best afternoon, morning, or evening that you have ever had. Take care.